All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our event tonight. Thank you very much for making time for us. We decided to do this event because, of course, there was a surge of confusion and emotion and all kinds of reactions to, of course, the elections in the United States. And so we thought we would try relatively early to have a conversation about what we see happening in terms of the aftermath, in terms of American politics and society, of course, reactions in Europe, reactions globally for that matter, and what we see in the early stages of what will this Trump presidency be, how revolutionary is it, how radical is it, how much is it connected to the campaign, and what was said and done during the campaign, issues that really are emerging day by day, so evidence is early, but still shaping global politics already. Headline today, TPP, or the Trans-Pacific Partnership, is dead. Ist beerdigt, as it was reported on the front page of the Süddeutsche Zeitung. So we see, in terms of global geoeconomics and geopolitics, how the elections are already shaping global affairs in very, very important ways. So I was delighted when my colleague and friend, Professor Paul Rundquist, had time to join us. Those of you who are familiar with American Space, Leipzig, and American Studies and events we do know Professor Paul Rundquist. He is a well-known name, well-known national expert in Germany in terms of contemporary American politics. He comes with outstanding credentials, a PhD in political science from the University of Chicago, a full career at the Congressional Research Service, the research component of the U.S. Congress, an independent research body that serves both parties, and was seen during his career, still is, of course, as one of Washington, D.C.'s leading experts in the relations between Congress and the White House, the executive branch, and overall how D.C. works and how American politics works. He's been a senior Fulbright professor in Poland, senior Fulbright professor in Germany, and is asked to speak at conferences and events regularly, not just in Germany, but throughout Europe. So we're absolutely delighted you could join us, Paul. Thank you very much. And let's give a warm welcome to Professor Paul Rundquist. So I'm a professor, which means I have a huge ego. And that means I'll also be talking a little bit. And what Paul and I worked out is what we would do is he would start with a few opening observations, what he saw as causing the election results that occurred. I would speak for a few minutes about what I see happening, and then we would ask each other questions about how we see the results from the elections, because as you know, there's an open debate about how did this result happen as it did. Among experts are differences of opinion or analysis, obviously similar conclusions. Have a little bit of a conversation about that, then move into a little bit of a conversation about what we see happening now and during the transition period. Each talk just a little bit about that. I'm talking about very, very short sort of opening statements. We would sort of ask each other questions about our thoughts about that. And then have lots of time for Q&A, for questions and answers and discussion, and really have you engaged in the room in terms of what you see, what you're confused about, what you're angry about, what you'd like to talk about, and bring that into the conversation, okay? All right, so Paul, without further ado, you have the floor.
Thank you. I'm gonna move my chair a bit to the left because this wonderful plant here.
Is a bit getting, aggressive?
Well, it's getting in the way of seeing the folks on that edge, so I'll do that, as long as I'm still in camera sight. Okay, good. Now, first thing to remember is, of course, the election is still not over. The state of Michigan is having a hard time counting its votes. It's so close in the state of Michigan that they're waiting for the U.S. Postal Service to deliver absentee ballots from outside the United States. And as long as your absentee ballot was postmarked by November 8th, your absentee ballot should be counted. And considering that the last time I checked, the margin of Trump victory in the state of Michigan is 1,500 votes out of something in the neighborhood of 5 million votes cast. Michigan hasn't decided who actually won yet. Plus, today's New York Times contains a story where some of the election watchers are charging that perhaps because the election turnout was so low that there is hacking going on in some of the big cities in Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, where they use computer registration of votes, that more people showed up to vote than actually had votes counted for them. We'll see what happens with this. So the game might not be over yet, but let's get real, okay? Let's get real and find out about it, and I'll lay some blame out here. Hillary lost because she lost sight of certain groups of voters, and basically, if we want to lay the blame, we can lay the blame on white women, black men, and millennials. Okay. Now, some of this is counterintuitive, but it's based on exit polling data that a consortium of pollsters took on election day based on 25,000 or so interviews that they took of what they consider as a suitable sample that reflects the rest of the population. First, I need to apologize to Crister. 8 months ago, on a moment of great optimism, I responded to a question from Crister when he asked, well, do you think the email scandal is going to hurt Hillary? And I said, oh no, with all the confidence of somebody who worked in Washington for 30 years, oh no, this will all go away. It will end up being nothing. Well, frankly, it ended up being nothing, but it ended up being nothing a week before the election. And by this point, it had tarnished the entire Hillary Clinton campaign. We all recall Bernie Sanders' wonderful comment that he was sick and tired of hearing about Hillary's damned emails. But the interesting thing about the exit polling, okay, we all thought that, that Donald Trump's reputation with women would scare off women voters. It didn't. The exit poll data shows that among white women, 53% of the white women in the United States voted for Trump. And if you look at a subgroup of this, non-college educated white women voted 62% for Trump, okay? Then, talking about black men, you remember Trump's famous speech in suburban Milwaukee, where he spoke directly to black voters saying, what the hell do you have to lose, okay? Black men responded to that, okay? Not in huge numbers, but enough, okay? Among black women, Hillary Clinton got 94% of the vote, okay? Among black men, Clinton got 80% of the vote. That is an incredibly low number for a Democratic Party candidate for president among black voters, okay? Among black male voters, 7% voted for others, okay, Jill Stein, Gary Johnson, 13% voted for Trump, okay? You say that's not historically a very high percentage. Yes, but in the blue belt states that we're all talking about, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, that's enough to make the difference, okay? Then let's talk about millennial voters, okay? Hillary Clinton should have experienced this in the campaign. Bernie Sanders experienced it during the campaign. When you rely on millennial voters, they've got something better to do than go vote, okay? And the millennial voters, horrifyingly for a Clinton campaign, went for Trump, okay? The exit polls show that voters 18 to 29 years old voted 48% for Trump and 43% for Clinton. That's a horrifying statistics for Democratic planners, okay? So the other thing, of course, is that fewer than 50% of millennials bothered to vote at all. So the folks that you see on some of the American demonstrations that are going on in the streets in several cities, realize that probably half the people on the streets demonstrating didn't bother to go to the polls on election day. So, in a sense, Jack Kennedy said after the Bay of Pigs invasion was a catastrophe, that victory has 1,000 fathers and defeat is an orphan. Okay? Nobody wants to take responsibility for this, but it was a serious loss from traditional Democratic voters. And the most interesting statistic and confusing statistic out of this for me is that families in the United States with an income of under $50,000 a year voted for Clinton, and it was the moderately successful people with $50,000 or above who voted for Trump. Okay? That is counterintuitive when we look at the states of Wisconsin, for example, or Michigan, where we see folks who traditionally would vote Democratic voting for Trump. Brown County in Wisconsin, headquarters of the Green Bay Packers football team, okay, voted for Trump. Okay, this is an industrial town. Okay, in Pennsylvania, Erie County, one of the three counties a Democrat has to carry in order to win the state, Erie County voted for Trump. Okay. That doesn't fit with this exit poll statistic that the lower income people supported Clinton. Okay, what do we know? There's a lot of blame to push around. And one of the things culturally to think about is, I'm an East Coaster. I haven't lived in the Rust Belt in 35 years. Okay, and when I lived in the Rust Belt, I lived in the elite cosmopolitan neighborhoods that were racially integrated in Chicago, okay? So I'm not a good example on this. But the bottom line is the Clinton people assumed most of their voters were happy with the cultural changes that went on during the last 8 years. They were happy with gay marriage. They were happy with transgender toilet policies from the Department of Education, that they were happy with gender integration in the military, that all military jobs would be open to women who could qualify. And obviously, a significant number of people aren't, okay, based on the election results. That's a miscalculation on the part of Democratic planners. That's the bad thing to say about it. The good thing to say about this in the end is the Democrats didn't lose by much, okay, but they lost by enough to lose the presidential election, and they lost by enough to cause many other politicians that would be good for the party in the future to lose in campaigns for the Senate, campaigns for governor, all the way down to state legislatures. And the end result is going to be, I think, a purge of Democratic Party leadership in the Congress and in the national party organizations. And we'll see what happens and who moves into positions of power within the Democratic Party. That's enough, I think.
Thank you very much, Paul. It's a wonderful start. Like you said, there's many causes, many moving pieces, a lot of complexity here, and we're not going to be able to cover it in our opening statements. Maybe we can fill it out during our conversation, but I'll pick up on Wisconsin, maybe, where my wife and I lived for 7 years in Madison. And Madison is one of the few areas that Hillary Clinton took. It's a university town. It's, I guess, a Midwest version of Tübingen or something like that, a very sort of liberal, progressive university town. But in Madison County, this depicts into what you're saying, we had friends who lived in the suburbs. And once you get to the suburbs of Madison, the heart of Madison is Hillary Clinton country, mm-hmm. and buys into the sort of the postmodern sort of society that you're talking about. But in the suburbs where we had wonderful friends, it's quite clear that's where you saw a lot of Trump signs in the yards, mm-hmm. and really Trump supporters. And as you move further out into the countryside, also Trump supporters. So, you know, Wisconsin is a good measure to see the political geography of the United States and what happened during this election. I think I would, just to keep it brief, offer maybe three frames to sort of bring it into thinking about language and the narratives that were offered and the impact they had. And I would take two from, I think, what has shaped Donald Trump's thinking about politics, and I think will shape politics generally for both parties moving on. And then sort of two classical components that are always in tension in American politics, and what really happened, and how that shaped the election results. So I'd like to talk about the metaphor of real estate, political real estate. I'd like to talk about the metaphor of reality TV and the language of this election and the narratives that emerge from that, and the tension and trade-offs between risk and change and how that shaped voter behavior. Mm-hmm. So let's take real estate first. We all know Donald Trump's a real estate man, and I think he looked at this election like buying real estate, and where was the political real estate that was available with which he could have success? And when he looked at a politics, and he looked at the Hillary Clinton campaign, and he looked at the Jeb Bushes of the world, he realized the real estate that was not really being addressed was a working class America, a fragile middle class. When you talked about that 50,000 and below, I think one way to look at that is if you're an American family in the United States now, and you're right around the $50,000 a year income family, you're not poor, but you are middle class fragile. Mm-hmm. You are middle class fragile. And so the relative position and sense of security, social status and security, is very fragile at that level. We see that in other studies that actually the new middle class in the United States, in terms of a sense of security and relative stability, mm-hmm. is 75,000 and above. So that has really shifted as the country has gone post-industrial mm-hmm. into an informational economy. So I think what Trump saw, and people were mocking him last year about that, and you know, experts like you and me were saying he had no chance, was that, and we see that exactly with Wisconsin, right? After the Democratic Party convention in August, Hillary Clinton did not go a single time to the state of Wisconsin. She just assumed this real estate was secure for her, right? The so-called blue wall, mm-hmm. right? The blue wall was secure. Wisconsin, Michigan, and et cetera. Donald Trump saw something different. And I love your quote about saying, what the hell do you have to lose? Mm-hmm. That will come to risk and change, mm-hmm. right? Because I think that's really what they calculated. People... Yeah. Change will trump risk, mm-hmm. no pun intended, in terms of voter behavior. So I think this has large implications for the Republicans and the Democrats moving forward. We'll talk about that later. The political real estate of the United States. I think Trump has he saw the map, the real estate market, the political real estate market in a way that very few others did, or did not want to believe that real estate market existed as it did, and ignored it. Obviously to their peril and to their loss, so to speak. Mm-hmm. He always had a very disciplined approach to his clientele. I mean, from what we can read now, last year they had a very specific strategy how they could possibly win. They didn't necessarily believe they would. Actually, they believed they wouldn't win, right? That would work so well. So I think looking at the political real estate of the United States, frankly, Trump, in important ways, even though it was close and you talked about a purge in the Democratic Party. I think that's a powerful statement, has changed the map in terms of that. Reality TV is another metaphor. This gets to risk and change as well. A lot of Trump supporters says you don't understand his language. Yeah, his language is offensive, but it's reality TV language. It's big time wrestling language. It's the kind of thing, you're going down. No, you're going down. It's kind of over the top, dramatic, reality TV, crude language. The way reality TV works is by being offensive in important ways. It has developed a different type of vaudeville narrative and language. The freak show, sort of the awkward, the confrontational. Reality TV as a form of popular culture emerges from working class English TV. The English really develop reality TV as a genre. The US imports it from England. And it's really working class English TV in the sense of how do you create a vaudeville working class blue collar culture that makes for outrageous, enthralling TV, so to speak.
So Donald Trump is a descendant of Coronation Street.
Well, you know, let's put it, he's certainly a descendant of Shark Tank, The Apprentice, mm-hmm. reality TV. He thrives in that, yeah. right? He absolutely yeah. thrives. He is fluent in that language. Hillary Clinton doesn't even know the language. She doesn't even know the language. Hillary, I mean, Donald Trump is fluent in that language. He really socialized himself in this language and speaks that language. So when he goes to working class neighborhoods, or even minority neighborhoods, I mean, reality TV is not white TV. It cuts across minorities. So it's a type of working class popular culture. And I think that's going to have large implications for who the Democrats look to encourage in terms of as the party moves mm-hmm. forward. Who in the party speaks reality TV mm-hmm. as a politician in terms of class and culture and connectivity? Donald Trump is a billionaire. Gets that. I think that's clearly been part of his power. And if we look at the exit polling, many people said that. He said, yeah, he was outrageous. Yeah, his language is over the top. But you don't understand how he's communicating with us. And if I read the New York Times coverage, which I do every day, you can see the New York Times still doesn't get it. Right? It's like they're going to some exotic island and trying to figure out what the natives think about this language, right? You can see there's just no connection there. Right? The New York Post gets it, mm-hmm. right? The Boulevard Press gets it, so to speak, right?
Yeah.
But I think that's something, there we see class and culture and politics, I think, and that really, I think Donald Trump really exposed that in this election and succeeded with that. And I think the last place where you see that, last thing I would say, is in the trade-off between risk and change. In Wisconsin, this was very big in many states, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, and many people ask, how is it possible that two-thirds of Americans don't think he's fit for the office, and yet they voted for him? And the risk versus change frame helps us understand that, right? Mm-hmm. People say, yeah, it's risky. But Hillary Clinton represents so much status quo, and we're so desperate for change, mm-hmm. we'll take change over risk. Change trumps risk. And you can see that in a lot of the exit polling. And so, you know, the Clinton team betted on risk. If we run the risk narrative, he's too risky, people will be fearful enough that they won't, that the change will be drowned out by that. And what we saw was voters didn't calculate it the same way. Mm-hmm. They had a different rational expectations vote on that. I don't know what the Democratic Party does with that moving forward, but we see, if we think about the last three elections, Barack Obama twice, and now Donald Trump this year, the last three have been dominated by the change narrative versus the risk narrative. And I think that's something that the Democratic Party is going to have to think about in terms of, again, who they promote in terms of national politics. Who really is credible mm-hmm. as a voice of change, whether it's Bernie Sanders or somebody else. Okay, maybe that just is sort of as three sort of thoughts, real estate, reality TV, and risk versus change.
Yeah.
Let me ask you something about, because Paul and I were exchanging emails as we were getting ready for tonight, and I told Paul, I said, any seminar he would offer, I would sign up for. he is such a vast storage of knowledge of American politics, and he has endless amounts of stories. And one thing
endless
was,
amounts of stories. Yes.
In a positive way. In a positive way. You don't repeat them. So, But you were talking about, you could remember the days where, you know, in terms of unions and Democratic Party functions, where the halls would be filled and Democrats could really fire up a union hall. Mm-hmm. And so my question to you is, if you look at these industrial states, and you think, and you know deeply this past of the Democratic Party in this part of the country, and you sort of, you know, we're all reading the results coming out of the election now. What sort of tentative options do you see for the Democratic Party in areas like Wisconsin, Michigan, Ohio, Pennsylvania, and these, because you know this area, you grew up in Chicago, around Chicago, mm-hmm. in the Midwest, etc. What are some of your initial thoughts about that? Where does the Democratic Party go from here?
Yeah. I'm perhaps the only person in the room who can say that I used to be a steel worker, okay? It paid my way through university back in the days when steel workers made $2.69 an hour. Now, that's a long time ago, but the tuition at my university for BA courses was at that time something in the neighborhood of $800 per semester. So that basically indicates to you how old I am, okay? But I remember the beginning of political campaigns for president. Always used to be Detroit, because that was the headquarters of the CIO, the Congress of Industrial Organizations, the Industrial Union, the automobile workers, Walter Reuther, leader in the civil rights movement and stuff, and you would have a gathering on Labor Day, the first Monday in September, in downtown Michigan at a place called Cadillac Square, and the unions would put 500,000 people in Cadillac Square to hear the opening speech by a Democratic Party candidate for president. Well, there aren't 500,000 people still living in Detroit. Okay, and if they showed up in downtown in Cadillac Square, several thousand of them would probably be assaulted. It's a dangerous, declining, depressed town. And in the 1960s, 33% of the workers in the United States were union members. 11% of the workers in the United States are now union members, okay? And the biggest unions are knowledge workers. What's the biggest union in the United States? Teachers. It's not steel workers, okay? And so that shows the shift in this traditional economy. And in a sense, Bill Clinton is responsible for this. Bill Clinton was famous in 1992 in his campaign for going to industrial states and explaining those jobs are gone. The blue-collar manufacturing jobs are gone. You've got to change. You've got to change with this, and we will help you change. Bottom line, though, is in the 24 years since Bill Clinton ran for president, nobody has seriously helped to change the skill levels of the workers who have lost their jobs to the new multinational economy. And somebody with the name of Clinton paid the price, I think, seriously for this year. Now, that's not to say that this is a new phenomena, okay? This has been true for a long time. My wife's family is from Youngstown, Ohio. Okay, I've been going to Youngstown, Ohio since 1968, and I've watched Youngstown, Ohio decline. Okay, first a close of a Chevrolet factory, then a close of steel mills, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, so that at the moment, Youngstown, Ohio lives to support a state university campus and to serve as a cheap commuting suburb of Cleveland for people who work in knowledge industries in Cleveland. there's no manufacturing to speak of left. And the only steel that's left is very high-priced specialty steel, because everybody else outside the United States can make traditional steel cheaper. There's been no change in that sort of environment. So how you handle this is an interesting problem, because there's two things going on here. You can retrain workers for jobs that are there. The problem is, frequently the jobs are not where the workers are, okay? And so if you are in a declining town like Youngstown, Ohio, your choice is to somehow survive on low-skill, low-pay jobs in a declining town where at least it's cheap to live, or to move to a different place. And there are a lot of people in the middle of the country who don't see themselves as geographically mobile. This is where I'm from. Why should I move? This is where my family has been for several generations, maybe many generations. And you want me to move to one of these foreign culture places like suburban Manhattan? Okay.
Or even worse, California.
Yes. Could be, you know.
Where I'm from.
So that's the sort of situation you can get into. Now, nobody has figured out how to get around this problem yet of jobs not being where the retrained workers might be. The alternative is, what do you do to support these workers who are never going to work at a job that can pay them enough to be modestly comfortable? And so you got what Crister and I were talking about before we started. You get the lady who's at the cash register at the Walmart grocery store. She's at the Walmart grocery store because it's a job anybody can do. Universal product code gets read by the cash register automatically. The cash register even tells her how much the change she will have to make for the cash payment, okay? It is a low-skill, boring, nowhere job that brings in a small amount of money to supplement the small amount of money that perhaps her husband, partner, whatever, is making in a similarly unskilled job. It's not a great job. It's not a job you want to pass on to your children necessarily, but it's there, okay? What do you do with people like that, okay? There are 3 million workers in the United States at this moment who have one job. They drive motor vehicles for a living. We're developing computer-driven cars and trucks. In 20 years, many of those jobs will disappear. What are we going to do with those people? Okay? Donald Trump said, we got to look out for these people somehow. He hasn't said how, but we got to look out for them. He at least recognized them. And you're right, I think Hillary didn't. Now, let me ask you in this context, the framing of the debate, the exaggerated language, does that mean truth is the victim of this election? That exaggeration, frankly, on both sides, but clearly Donald has won overwhelmingly in this category, that the exaggerated language of the debates and of campaign speeches in general has moved any sort of rational discourse out of national politics?
We'll have to see. I mean, we see technically in terms of you know, we see now, you know, certain contrition from outfits like Facebook and Google in terms of monetizing so-called news and types of news. I certainly don't think it moves. Again, we have to think about this. Two-thirds of Americans thought he was not qualified for the office. That was based on statements clearly that he had made and performance in the debates and other episodes. So I think what he has done with social media and, like I said, a reality TV narrative has created a new chapter in America's political vocabulary and strategy in terms of what we mean by fact, fiction, and narrative. Like you said, presidential campaigns are always about pushing as far as you can notions of fact and certain types of narrative, right? Mm. I mean, the Pinocchio checker for the Washington Post has been very active the last 12 years, not just the last year, so to speak, right?
Yeah.
Whether it's, you know, Democrats or Republicans, so to speak. So, but you're right, it's obviously had a new quality this season, and I think for the Republican Party, they'll have to see, I mean, in certain ways, Donald Trump is a unique personality in terms of American politics. Mm-hmm. And in certain ways, like you can say for the Democrats, Barack Obama is a unique personality. Where's the next Barack Obama? No one has any idea, right? Mm-hmm. You can't look out there and say, aha, there's the next Barack Obama. So, in certain ways, you know, whether Barack Obama or Donald Trump, they're really unique personalities that bring unique gifts. You know, Barack Obama's is one that, you know, it's the Camelot narrative. It's everything we like to sort of see in ourselves, and Republicans were inspired by it, and you know, 8 years ago. And of course, Donald Trump is really the vaudeville, ugly, crass, garish side of America that has always been there. Mm-hmm. That has always been there. And has been woven into the American story from very early on. I mean, that's why I think we're going to hear a lot more about Andrew Jackson now than we have in a long time. Because if we go all the way back to the late 1820s, we're going to see a lot of these sort of notions of patrician class, populist class, class per se in terms of culture. Mm-hmm. So no, we're not post-fact. I think what we're really going to look at is really the relationship between language, fact, reporting, and politics, and see how voters and institutions react to that. I mean, we'll come to the second part now. I think we're seeing clearly that, at least early on, Donald Trump is beginning to back away from a lot of that strategy, right? Mm. Now he is president, or president in waiting, you know, transitioning. And realizing that those strategies simply won't work at this stage now, as entering a different phase of political life, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Maybe we'll talk a little bit about that. What do you see happening right now in terms of the Trump presidency? What scares you? What reassures you? Tom Friedman from the New York Times saying it's going to be okay in his latest column. Do you think it's going to be okay, or where are you in this debate?
It's not probably going to be as bad as we liberal Democrats think, okay? In part because Donald Trump has some Democratic Party tendencies still left in him. So in that sense, some of the things that are going to happen are going to be things that Democrats in the Congress and Democrats in the country can support. If he goes for infrastructure work, expanding, this has been a problem ever since the Venda in the United States. I remember a congressman I was working for at the time that the wall came down, Lee Hamilton, international Democrat from Indiana, saying, now we can turn towards domestic investment. Now we don't have to spend as much on defense. And it never happened. Mm. It never happened 25 years ago. Okay, starting then, it hasn't happened. Those bridges that are falling down are still falling down, and they need to be replaced. Now, perhaps since Germany uses standard type bridges to cross over autobahns, we could just bring some of those over. But in any event, he'll get a lot of Democratic support if he endorses this and moves forward with it. I'm concerned about Breitbart News owner working as a White House counselor in a position that is not accountable to the Congress, as a basically a personal employee of the president. I think Bannon is a risky choice, but probably one that needed to be made.
I interject? Why is that? Why did it have to be made? Why do you say that?
I think you got to have your campaign leadership involved in the White House somehow. Mm-hmm. Unless one of the top leaders in your campaign says, that's the last thing I ever want to do. I do politics. I don't do governing. I do elections. I don't do handling the bureaucracy. That's not what I'm good at. And we've seen some people in past campaigns who have told the president-elect, onamik, not me in the White House staff. Now, the interesting thing to me is Kellyanne Conway, the manager, daily manager of the campaign, is hinting that she's not going into the White House. I want to know why. Okay, what happened? Did she get pushed out, frozen out? Does she feel uncomfortable in whatever work environment is going on with Trump? And I'm concerned about some of the arch conservatives like Senator Sessions as Attorney General. I think he's got many scores he wants to settle that he's picked up over the years from the time where he was denied an appointment as a federal judge. So I'm a bit concerned about that. I'm surprised at some of the choices. For somebody who wants to drain the swamp, to use that election term, there are a few too many folks who have hip boots on because they've been working in the swamp for a long time. Okay, so before Bannon invested in the Breitbart News Service, he was a hedge fund manager on Wall Street. The person who is likely to be named Treasury Secretary is an investment banker at Goldman Sachs. Okay, so there's not enough swamp cleaners that are actually making the cut. Group A of political observers says that's reassuring. The American stock market is really excited, okay, at this moment. But Group B are the folks back in Walmart jobs who said, this is not what we expected. Okay, we'll see how this actually plays out as things go along in putting the administration together. And of course, the big thing to watch for, I think, is who's he gonna nominate for the Supreme Court vacancy? Okay, clearly the current Senate will never act on Judge Garland's nomination for the Supreme Court vacancy. The nomination automatically is returned to the president when the Congress adjourns at the end of this Congress. And Obama can resubmit his name because he's still a president on January 3rd, but why do it, okay? So somewhere after January 20th, there'll be a nominee from Trump for the Supreme Court. Who does he name? What kind of judge does he pick? Okay, that will be an interesting thing to observe. But bear in mind one saving grace for people who are worried. That just would recreate the Supreme Court as it existed before Judge Scalia died, okay? That would still give you four conservatives, four liberals, and one in the middle, okay? And that is an interesting thing to keep watching to see if the Supreme Court voting pattern changes any under a Trump administration. That could be very fascinating to observe. I have I have great confidence in Chief Justice Roberts, who occasionally votes in ways that he thinks are necessary to preserve the dialogue in the country.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, I agree with you in much of your analysis, in the sense of there's many things you can be concerned about, deeply worried about, to put it in more straightforward language. I think there's surprising developments in terms of the language and the promises made during the election and what we're beginning to see now. You know, a list of things. Maybe climate change is human caused. Hillary won't necessarily go to jail. The wall might not be pure cement. There might be some spaces where we can be more, imaginative, et cetera. So we're seeing a combination. And I found your analysis very interesting in terms of the types of personalities or people coming into the administration. I'd like to pick up, first of all, on Stephen Bannon, also Breitbart News senior counselor, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And then the chief of staff position. You know much more about that, but the importance of the chief of staff. So chief of staff is classic Republican Party and expertise mm-hmm. and insider. And senior counselor is the outsider, Stephen Bannon. Also, a concern for many people is the national security advisor, General Flynn. Mm-hmm. But I'd like to say in his views, but what I find interesting, and it goes back to your observation that Trump in many ways is a Democrat in certain ways in terms mm-hmm. of programs, right? Infrastructure, even social democracy. Mm-hmm. Moderate social Democrats could propose that in terms of, billions for bridges and roads and things like that. But if we look at Flynn as national security advisor and Bannon as senior counselor, what's so interesting about these two men is they started off early in life and early adulthood as Democrats. They grew up in Democratic households. Flynn has voted for the Democratic Party up until very recently. And then it was his disagreements with Barack Obama about policy in Afghanistan that caused, real differences in terms of what do we mean by national security. And I mention that in terms of Bannon and Flynn because I think for better or for worse, if you're a Democrat, let's say, mm-hmm. they represent not neoconservatives, like many neoconservatives in the early 2000s were former Democrats who, mm-hmm. because of Vietnam and other issues, sort of went to the Republican Party. But I think that's been part of the Democratic Party's support that the Democratic Party is going to have a hard time doing it because the reality is so-called Franklin Delano Roosevelt Democrats, right? I mean, this is the kind of household that Bannon grew up in. Mm-hmm. FDR, John F. Kennedy Democrats, so to speak, which are culturally quite conservative. If not outright conservative.
Well, we could look back to Barack Obama, who was not all that enthusiastic about gay marriage at the beginning of his presidency. And the cultural appeal in his voting patterns in the two elections were the parts of the country that Hillary Clinton lost this time. There are 200 counties that Clinton lost in this election that Obama carried twice before, okay? And a lot of these are probably these culturally conservative units that have said basically that's too far.
Okay. In terms of sexuality in the military, for example, he only did that after re-election in 2012. In terms of fulfilling the legacy left by Bill Clinton, in terms of integrating the military fully in terms of that, and statements and politics around gay rights only came after 2012 and re-election. So just sort of to support your point.
Yeah.
I mean, looking forward, I mean, I find it interesting, for example, in terms of maybe Mitt Romney as Secretary of State, for example. I mean, that is a surprising choice, I think, for most people, at least, in terms of thinking about what Mitt Romney, where he was during the campaign, right? Really one of the most vociferous Republicans against Donald Trump. And Donald Trump had, of course, clear words for him in return.
Must have been a wonderful conversation.
Yeah, no kidding, right? Two disciplined professionals, so to speak. So I think, again, it's obviously too early to see, but I think we see interesting things happening in terms of, you could say, both, the pressure of the White House and the reality of being in this office seems to be shaping him rapidly. I think sort of the pressure to be able to work with Congress in a Republican Party that actually has diverse constituencies. And I think going back to risk and change, he's looked at the polling numbers. He's seen 2/3 of Americans don't think he's appropriate for the White House. Mm-hmm. How does he change that? In other words, the people, I think, overall, he realizes his numbers are not about a surge, like you said in your analysis, of popularity for the man and his agenda. Mm-hmm. It was a close race. Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by over 1 million votes. He sees those numbers as well, of course, yeah. Right? So if you want to be Tom Friedman, cautious optimistic, you can argue that all these different things are contributing to creating a relatively more moderate Donald Trump than we would have anticipated even 2 weeks ago, perhaps. We'll see. We're very, very early in the process. Yeah. I would have a quick question for you in terms of that. Is this something that you have seen in the past in terms of we have campaign season, then we have transition season, and during transition in the early days in office, the famous 100 days, you see oftentimes, whether it was the era of Ronald Reagan mm-hmm. or the era of Bill Clinton, for example, where there was very strong, emotional, confrontational language during the campaign. And then as these teams began to transition, you could see them begin to already, even early on, begin to try to build coalitions of different voices and a certain mm-hmm. centrism that will allow them to rule and get things through Congress.
Well, I'm thinking back at George W. Bush and the transition from the Bush-Gore election, which makes this election so far look quiet. We haven't had riots counting the ballots in Florida like we did in 2000. And so, in a sense, we're getting something of that sort of let's everybody quiet down and move forward here. I think part of it has to do with the fact that within the Congress, on the Democratic side, there's this leadership turmoil going on, that the old Congress is still in business. The Congress that was elected 2 weeks ago won't officially take over until January. So you have some sort of leadership selection process going on, and there's no clear-cut message from the Congress on how people want to go. But in the issue about smoothing things over, let's imagine a Trump White House for a moment, at least until next June, the end of the school year, where Trump is separated from his wife and school-age child for the work week, okay? Trump can work 16 hours a day as president because the family's up in New York, okay? He can learn the job, and he can spend time with the staff making sure he doesn't make too many gross mistakes. So there's a possibility there if you're looking optimistically about this. And second is we don't know who the people under some of these folks are going to be. So the National Security Advisor is actually the head of an entire research operation that has probably about 150 people working in it either full-time or on rotation into it from the military or other bureaus that handle intelligence issues and things like that. And the same goes for economic advisor when we start moving into the economy side of the cabinet and advisors. There's these second-level people who turn out to be tremendously influential when their subject specialty turns up on the agenda. So there's an issue, how do you pay for this infrastructure? Okay, do you privatize it and offer incentives to private companies to build bridges and highways for you, or better internet access, or do you have the government do this? Okay, and we have historical precedents for both things going on in the United States. Mm-hmm. And who are the people running economic policy issues and other issues within the White House staff and in the agencies below the cabinet level? Because the cabinet level people are, frankly, very good at public work for the agencies, but they're not the ones who are actually supervising major portions of a large agency on a day-to-day basis. You don't expect the Secretary of Health and Human Services to know why the computer system crashed on the first day of Obamacare going in. That's somebody else's job below the secretary to take the heat for
it
that.
It was someone else's job.
Yes.
Yes. Past tense was perfect in that situation. Yeah.
Yes. So we still don't know about this, and that's one of the problems with transitions.
Yeah.
They take time.
Yeah.
Even the best planning. I got a very influential friend in Washington who served in a presidential appointment job for Bill Clinton in Clinton's second term. George Bush did not get around to replacing him in his really very nice job, thank you, until November of the first year of the Bush administration. Okay, so he continued to stay in Rome until November of 2001. Okay, that's a nice transition period. Okay, so we'll see how fast Trump's people get around to these less visible but important secondary jobs in the transition.
Okay, thank you very much. We can open the floor now if you have questions for us. If you can just stand up and ask the question, and I'll repeat it so our audience can hear that, and then we can entertain it. You can really ask about anything, the election results, what you see happening, what is confusing, what you'd like to critique, express different thoughts. Really, the floor is wide open.
Oh, come on.
Come on, you millennials. Yes, Rebecca. No, sorry, Jessica. Sorry, excuse me. Sorry.
I guess this is something that I've been hearing a lot in the news lately. It's about like how his business dealings are currently even like a big topic, and how he's somehow bringing in business dealings when he's talking to these foreign diplomats. And so I want to know like what your opinion is and how it's going to work out with like the Trump organization, like if there's going to be kind of like a new era of, well, you don't have to put it in a blind trust and you can have your business dealings and still be in government.
Yeah, so let me just repeat the question so very good question. How is Trump going to really organize his business empire along with his political, you know, responsibilities or political empire so that we don't have issues of corruption or even the perception of corruption, right? Which is just as important in terms of the integrity of the institution, right?
Yeah.
Why don't you address it? What do you see happening? Maybe you can also talk about the federal laws that emerged, especially in the 1970s a little bit, in terms of corruption and nepotism and how important those laws are.
Well, the problem is that the president stands apart from most of the ethics laws that apply in Washington. Nobody assumed in writing most of these ethics regs that someone so independently wealthy and so heavily involved in private sector business would be elected president. This is an unprecedented issue. Probably you have to go all the way back to George Washington. Washington was an incredibly wealthy person in 18th century terms, okay? In a new country with not very many rich people, Washington was probably in the upper one half of 1% in wealth, okay? And George said, oh, I don't want to take my salary. I'll just take expenses. Well, Washington was notorious for padding his expense account, okay? But moving currently, the people who work for Trump, the people who take cabinet positions and other things have very stringent ethics requirements, requiring them to segregate their private funds from their professional activities, okay? When I worked in Washington as a senior bureaucrat, I operated under the supervision of an ethics committee in the Congress, and every year I had to file a financial disclosure form that listed my income and my other jobs, okay, teaching at night, okay, speaking payments, honoraria, things like that, stocks that I owned, the amount of money in my private pension planning account, okay, disclose everything, the value of my house, how much did I owe on paying off the house, boom, okay. That's common for anybody above at senior management level or above in the federal government. And it's the higher you get to a presidential appointment position or a position that requires congressional approval to get, the disclosure requirements are more stringent. And the best example of a major person taking an appointment was Nelson Rockefeller as vice president when he was filling a vacancy in the job of vice president and was confirmed by the Congress. It took a long time for the Congress to agree to allow him to become vice president until he put the enormous Rockefeller holdings that he was a part of separately from this. What's different about the president is, A, the president is the president, not some subordinate. And second is the issue that the Trump enterprise is what is called in the ethics laws a closely held firm. That's to say, the business is Donald Trump. And the business is not Donald Trump without Donald Trump. And so the issue is, can Trump, in fact, create a blind trust that satisfies the notion of a blind trust? And is it really necessary for the president to do this if it is impossible? Donald Trump is always going to know where that golf course in Scotland is and how it's doing, okay? Or how the hotel four blocks from the White House in Washington is doing, because it's four blocks from the White House. So the question is, do you let this continue? And the answer is, the ethics code is vague, is the nice way to put it, on this issue, okay? Now, having said this, realize Donald Trump probably made a profit out of his presidential campaign, okay? He wasn't paying for that airplane to fly around. He leased his airplane to the Republican National Committee that paid for renting the airplane that was flying him around with the big Trump sign on it, okay? And presumably, he stayed at Trump hotels when he was in a place where there was a Trump hotel to stay in, okay? Good for business. Who's paying for it? The campaign is paying for it. The party is paying for it. In effect, this was a very good business investment running for president, okay? So the simple answer is, it's not simple to figure out how this is going to be regulated. Having said that, of course, there's also Donald Trump's statement that he wants people who take an appointment with the administration to sign a statement that they have stopped being a lobbyist, okay, and that they will pledge not to be a lobbyist for 5 years after leaving government service. That is virtually unenforceable, okay? Basically, the courts have ruled in the past that this is an unnecessary infringement on your right to go and seek a job, okay? And besides, there are many ways around this. So that, for example, Rudy Giuliani was never a registered lobbyist, but he had a lot of registered lobbyists who worked for him in his firm. And that's an easy way around that little problem. So, yes, it's nice to say, I'm going to clean the swamp, but there's too many people still waiting around in the swamp or planning on waiting in it in the future.
You know, maybe one thing very, very interesting what I would add is what's interesting about what we're seeing in the polling coming afterwards is how many voters see the relationship between Donald Trump, the business person, and Donald Trump, the politician. And what many voters have said in exit polls is the very fact that he is a business person and very wealthy actually makes him less corruptible. Because he's not going into the office to earn money necessarily. If it's true or not in terms of the brand and everything, you know, who knows. But this is what many voters feel, that sort of the Tony Blairs of the world or the Bill Clintons of the world didn't have this independent wealth before coming into office. And they actually used their office to build networks to then afterwards be able to consult and hold speeches and make $250,000 for a 30-minute speech. Point being, many voters said Donald Trump doesn't need that. He has this type of, so there's kind of a counterintuitive argument there. How can you be for the working class as a billionaire? Mm-hmm. And for the working class, exhausted from 25 years, as you point out very powerfully, of Bill Clinton's and Hillary Clinton's and promising to do something, but not really having much of a record about that. And of course, Donald Trump used that powerfully during the campaign, right? Unfairly, you might add.
Yeah.
You've been in power for 30 years and haven't done anything about that. I mean, she wasn't in the White House for 30 years, obviously, but the image was there.
Yeah. The image that you can't be bribed because you've got enough money already has a certain appeal to American voters in the past. Franklin Roosevelt. Comfortably wealthy, okay? Dwight Eisenhower, a nice government pension for serving 40 years in the military. Jack Kennedy, not as wealthy as Donald Trump, but close enough.
The Kennedy family, patrician family at that point
yes.
in terms of American politics.
Yeah.
Good point. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. And maybe this is also the reason why he is doing something like, for example, the emulation of the TPP.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think this is a very interesting, thank you very much for that observation. I think an important observation, right? We see during the 1990s, so-called third way. And we see that's really a transatlantic phenomenon. We see it with Tony Blair in Great Britain. We see it with Bill Clinton. In the United States, we see it with Gerhard Schröder in Germany in the late 1990s. So Democrats, Labor, Social Democrat coming to power and sort of embracing or accepting a neoliberal narrative or a liberal narrative about globalization and liberalizing the rules for managing, you know, advanced economies. And by doing that, really showing or creating growing gaps in the political sociology of these parties, right? We saw this with the Brexit vote. We see this rapidly with the Social Democrats now in Germany, really sort of what you said, the teacher union, white collar, democratic movement, yeah. right? We see this in Germany, Great Britain, and the United States, right? Mm-hmm. These are the voters who vote for Tony Blair, for staying in the EU, for Hillary Clinton, for TPP to a certain extent, for a certain type of social democracy. And Donald Trump, in terms of, if I may use the real estate metaphor again, saw the real estate that had been abandoned mm-hmm. with that and said, I'm going to address this clientele, and even though they were Democrats or former Democrats, mm-hmm. And was able to really say, I am going to, as a billionaire, I'm going to challenge this liberalization, pro-globalization narrative because I see what it means for a lot of people.
Yeah. On the neoliberal side, let's talk about workers, okay, and the decline of labor unions, certainly in the United States, but not just limited to the United States. In a increasingly global economy, worker organizations are still nationalist. There's no global workers movement, okay? A perfect example is Volkswagen, before the exhaust scandal, building a factory in Tennessee.
Exactly.
The Automobile Workers Union was holding an election among the workers in the factory to get the Automobile Workers Union recognized as the legal bargaining agent for the workers. Okay? Was there any cooperation between the UAW union and IG Metall? Answer, no. Was there anything said by Volkswagen senior management that the Volkswagen tradition in Germany was to have a workers' council of close collaboration in planning for the operations in this? No. What was most important to Volkswagen was the fact that the state government in Tennessee had given them tax breaks for the next 15 years in order to encourage them to put this factory there. The government, the state government, was anti-union, and the workers in the Volkswagen factory, by a narrow margin, defeated the recognition of the Automobile Workers Union as their bargaining agent. In a sense, corporations working very well together cross borders, but the workers' organizations have not caught up with this global perspective of moving across borders. We have not heard anything from the American unions on the fact that there's, in this town called Detroit, there is also a suburb of Detroit called Windsor, Ontario, in which workers from Detroit cross every day into Canada to work in a General Motors assembly factory, and that workers from Windsor, Ontario cross every day to work in plants in Detroit. Okay? Did we hear anything from the automobile workers about this and how good some of these trade agreements are? No, we didn't. It was too traditional. Okay? And they haven't adjusted their bargaining position on a lot of political issues. The Democrats are ignoring them in traditional parts of the country. But by the same token, the traditional labor unions are not keeping up with a cross-border economy.
Very interesting. Yes?
So, I mean, like, starting probably with the
years of the Tea Party, there is a general like split in the Republican Party concerning these lines. And I was wondering whether you think that this will or might block Donald Trump in some of the things he wants to do, or it's probably more likely that the Republicans just trying to save their own power and just, to put it bluntly, just suck it up and just really wants to do.
It's a great question because, you know, so many times when Europeans look at American politics, naturally enough, they think of U.S. presidential politics as a different version of parliamentary politics from Europe in terms of party discipline and majorities and things like that. So the question about the relationship between Congress and the presidency now and where you see potentially the Republican Party going as a big tent party like the Democrats, what different signals do you see? What could you anticipate, let's say, a year out in terms of where the Republican Party is in terms of the White House?
I think you got to look back on Ronald Reagan's first term and first year as a role model here. And the thing I expect to be most interesting to watch is the budget process in the Congress. Because that operates under very special rules that don't apply to normal legislation. And if you can find a way to get a Trump legislative proposal into a budget-related bill, for example, to increase spending or cut spending or change taxes in some way, this so-called reconciliation bill that comes up in the spring of a fiscal year is going to be an important way for the Trump administration to get an early major victory in the Congress. There are time limits on the consideration of a reconciliation bill. You can't have a filibuster in the Senate on the reconciliation bill like you can on ordinary legislation. It's driven by time limits. And we'll see how unified the Republicans are in the Congress about this. The latter stages of the campaign, there were incredible numbers of Republicans coming back home, okay? If you looked at the exit poll numbers, more than 90% of the Democrats, of the people who say they are Democrats, voted for Hillary Clinton, and 90% of the Republican people voted for Trump. Okay? So the ideological differences that exist within the Republican Party, you know, Speaker Ryan in the House of Representatives has got to understand that his idea about budget process reform is probably not the same idea that Donald Trump has in mind, and they better figure out a way to work together on this. And Trump has the remarkable ability on this to say, I won when you guys weren't helping me. Okay? So this is, you know, Trump has got a tremendous amount of momentum, and he's got an opportunity within the first 3 months that he's president to start this budget reconciliation process as a way to do a lot of things that he wants to do legislatively, just like Ronald Reagan did in his first year through the budget reconciliation process back then. So I think that's what you should look for. And there are ways for Trump to sweeten the deal on this reconciliation process to bring along some of the Democrats, for example, on infrastructure. So put together enough on this so that it's a big win for you, and make sure you don't alienate too many people in your party, or if you do, bring in some Democrats to stay with you to balance this off. So that's what I would look for in the spring.
Yes, Laura.
I'm under the impression that we keep hearing and talking about
Donald Trump's presidency. I'm wondering what the actual chances are, or what actual positive change Donald Trump as a president might bring about for the American people, or maybe even the rest of the world.
So really, I think a very interesting question, and maybe I'll start with that. The question is, we hear about the risks and the dangers of the incoming administration. How can we possibly define the chances, the opportunities, so-called positive side to the administration coming? I'd stress, and we see that already. It goes back to the gentleman's observation earlier about the Democrats and sort of embracing a neoliberal narrative about trade, or emphasizing a component of the trade and liberalization. That is over. Mm. I think we're seeing now a much more honest debate about economic change and transformation that's been forced on both parties by Donald Trump occupying certain political real estate and seeing opportunity there talking about the forgotten citizens. I mean, it's powerful language. His very first statement after winning, he used the phrase the forgotten citizens, the forgotten voters, several times. It was quite clear that was linguistically and in terms of narrative very strategic. So I think he has confronted the Democratic Party with really thinking about what kind of national party does it want to be moving forward. Now, you can see that as a positive thing or a catastrophe. I think if you think of in terms of Democratic politics as a rupture in that politics, and in terms of transatlantic politics, I would say I have argued before Donald Trump is going to disrupt transatlantic relations in important ways that are not necessarily all negative. You can see the debate in Europe already changing. What do we mean by European security? What do we mean by European identity and security? What do we mean about commitment to NATO? What Donald Trump said about NATO during the campaign, a majority of Americans have been thinking for 20 years. What he did was he made that a campaign topic. What both Democrats and Republicans have had to do, or try to do, is hide NATO as much as possible from the campaign because they knew how voters felt about that. So he saw the real estate that wasn't being occupied and he took it. And so I think we're gonna see, depending on what you think about NATO and transatlantic relations, but for example, in 2 years you might see a debate where you see where European identity through the election of Donald Trump has actually become more solidified in areas of security because of the confrontational nature and part of his narrative. Europe has to do more for its own security. And then potentially falling through on that. So like any kind of disruptive moment, you can see real dangers, real problems, but you can also paint scenarios where potentially that can bring about change that people have been talking about for a long time, but because of a relatively comfortable and steady center or status quo, lacked incentive for more robust change. I think you can see that in trade politics. I think you can see that in security politics. I think you can see that in domestic American politics. I think you can see that in several different areas. It's an interesting question.
Yeah.
Do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah. Let's think about the groups that, in a sense, American politics is still an assembly of groups. And I'm most taken by the 20% vote of black men for Trump, okay? Or the Democrats only getting 80% of that group. If Trump delivers economic benefits to low-skilled, lower-income, black working-class people, that's a revolution in American politics. If the Republican Party can break the hold that the Democrats have had for a half century on black voting patterns in the United States, it changes the entire political dynamics of the United States. Okay. Now, I've picked on Detroit. Let me continue to do this. Okay. Detroit, in a sense, has two congressional districts worth focusing on. One congressional district on the white fringes of central city Detroit has been represented for 94 years by the same family in Congress, Democrats. Okay? Central City, Detroit, has been represented for 46 years by the same congressman. Okay? Have they been good for Detroit? Answer, Detroit used to be the fourth largest city in the United States. It's now barely in the top 10. Okay? Economy, economic growth, people moving away, whatever. So, in a sense, the Donald Trump line, what have you got to lose, resonates in places like that. And so if you can deliver on something, bringing in more jobs of whatever kind, some sort of reinvestment program, okay, into the central cities, that would be a major shift in the politics of the country. Whether it lasts, who knows, but it's worth a try. And it's something that the National Republican Party has not really been addressing in its prior campaigns, okay? Republican Party is the party of white people and a percentage of Hispanics in national terms, okay? You bring black people back into the party of Lincoln, okay, to any degree, that is a serious threat to the survival of the Democratic Party and is going to force the Democrats to respond in some way, the way we don't yet know. Okay, so in a sense, that would be good in domestic politics, shaking up the political coalitions of the major parties. And I think as well, renegotiating trade agreements is not necessarily a bad idea, okay? If this is a trade agreement, why do we need several thousand pages worth of agreement to allow for the movement of product A from country B to country C, okay? If we need 1,000 pages to do that, we're not doing free trade, we're doing regulated trade, and trade that is regulated in a specific way, okay? You want free trade, you can't have anything that's only one page long, okay, in an agreement like this, but it should be a lot shorter than several thousand pages, okay? And so, in a sense, forcing a renegotiation of some of these trade agreements is not necessarily a bad idea, considering that some of them have been in place for a quarter of a century or more, and it's probably time to look at them and reevaluate them anyway. Trump's put this on the agenda. That could work out fairly well. Maybe we could even get the labor unions in Mexico to work with the labor unions in the United States and Canada. That would be threatening.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you see any implications for the Electoral College, because I feel like it's taking a lot of blame, and it's kind of being questioned if the system is like a good system that is still in place. So I was just wondering if this election maybe could have any implications on that.
So a question, thank you very much. A big question in the room, everyone's talking about the future of the Electoral College. Hillary Clinton wins the popular vote, loses the Electoral College. We've seen that before, not often, but before.
Yeah.
What does that mean about the state of American democracy?
Yeah, I think the statistics, I think there's five presidential elections we can point to where one candidate won the popular vote and a different candidate won the electoral vote, the most recent being the Gore-Bush election in 2000. The problem has been in the past, when this has happened, there's been a flurry of interest in modifying the Electoral College or trying to get rid of the Electoral College idea. I don't think the Electoral College is going to be in danger of being dissolved
and replaced by popular vote in the Constitution. It serves a federal purpose, okay? That's to say, it recognizes the existence of states as political entities. If you went straight to popular votes, you could run for president and stay in New York or Los Angeles or Texas and never have to travel around the country. So I think that is one thing. Second thing to consider, though, is there's been quiet reform going on in state laws about how they interpret their authority under the Electoral College process. So, for example, we've got Maine. Donald Trump is getting one electoral vote out of Maine because he carried the Northern Maine Congressional District, okay, state of Maine and the state of Nebraska, split up their electoral vote. You get the two senatorial electoral votes for getting a majority in the state. And then you get electoral votes for each of the congressional districts within the state and how your vote is coming in there. So Trump won Northern Maine, Aroostook County, wonderful woodsy place. They should probably let moose vote there. There are more moose there than people. But he won that place, okay? He gets an electoral vote. That's a reform in the system, okay? And there are other proposals out there to change state law that say the electors from a particular state, regardless of their electoral results within the state, should be pledged to vote for the national winner of the popular vote. Okay? An interesting way around the system. Each state is free under the Constitution to determine how the electors from their state will function. Okay? So if the state wants to do that in the future, they could do it. But I just don't see the Electoral College being swept away in favor of popular votes.
Let me ask you just very directly, if you could wave a magic wand, would you get rid of the Electoral College tomorrow?
No, I'd keep it.
And can you explain briefly why?
I like the fact that you've got to pay attention to the states. And that, well, Donald Trump showed us something here, that you can win a national election by putting together a small state coalition with a few big states thrown in. Okay? That's a different approach than what the Democrats have been doing successfully in national elections the last two times. That's been generally a large state coalition and carrying fewer large states as opposed to carrying more geography with so many small states in that coalition. It complexitizes the electoral process so that you can't afford to ignore particular points. As you said earlier, Hillary Clinton didn't go to Wisconsin and paid the price electorally. Okay? So that's, I think, an important thing to preserve in the system.
And the flip side, of course, is what the Trump's team is saying. If there had not been an electoral college, and that picks up on your point, of course we would have run a different campaign then. Mm-hmm. So the popular vote, who knows what the popular vote would have been then. Would have spent a lot more time in parts of California, at least, Central Valley and the North and different parts where he did well anyways.
The interesting thing to think about at the moment is that there is a court case coming along that could have major impact on legislative bodies throughout the United States. There is a federal appeals court ruling on a 2-1 vote on the appeals court that said the Wisconsin state legislature was gerrymandered. You all know the term gerrymandered, I presume, by now, for political purposes. basically guaranteeing too many Republican seats based on the number of votes the Republicans got. Okay? Two judges, one appointed by a Republican president, one of the judges appointed by a Democratic president, two judges agreed that this was going too far constitutionally. This case will now go to the Supreme Court, okay, for review. The important thing is the Supreme Court on this issue is 4-4-1, presuming a Trump nominee goes into the conservative four. The swing vote out of this is Justice Kennedy, who has been looking for a case to come along to set up a standard to challenge politically unbalanced congressional districts. And this may be the case that has major impact in every legislative body in the United States if the Supreme Court says you have to apply a different standard, you have to be politically fair in the allocation of geography. That could be something really worth watching. And if you're computer literate, you can get plenty of jobs in the United States drawing maps for political purposes on how election districts would be drawn.
We have time for one more question. Who would like to ask a question? You, sir, in the middle.
Because in the beginning you mentioned that probably a lot of people that are on the streets right now didn't vote, but now they're on the streets protesting. And so the next question would be, do you think a significantly higher voter turnout would have changed the presidency, the vote? And
So the question, thank you very much for your question, obviously a very good set of questions. U.S. has one of the lowest voter turnout records among Western democracies. It was notably lower this time around compared to 4 years and 8 years ago. Would a higher voter turnout have made a difference in terms of the election result? And what's sort of the state of the debate about voter participation and democracy in America?
Well, I think this election, you know, the votes are still coming in by mail, but it looks as if 5 million fewer people voted this time, somewhere in the neighborhood of 5 million people. And the biggest penalty of the declining vote participation came to Hillary Clinton. Now, in this election, both candidates were viewed with distrust by a lot of voters, and that contributed to voters saying, I don't care, I'm staying home, or I can't decide, I'm staying home, or they're terrible choices, and I'm not even going to go and waste my vote by handing it out to a third party candidate. The Green Party did disastrously.
Yeah, so, and as did the Libertarians, lower than people anticipated.
So there was a general, I'm not going to go there, election reaction going on. The really interesting part is, okay, I'll be deliberately controversial here. Political parties don't want high voter turnout. They want their voters to come out. And so if the Republicans are unhappy with their candidate, the Democrats are perfectly fine, and vice versa, okay? I think it has to do with the motivation of voters. Trump motivated his voters, He motivated traditional Republicans ultimately to come out and vote in the end. But the difference for him was getting people who were estranged from the political process to come out and vote, in some cases, for the first time in years. Okay? That's where the difference tends to come in those blue states that Trump won along the northern border of the United States. Trump motivated some groups of voters to participate more than they had in the past, and that changes the outcome. Now, there are also, to be candid, people who argue that there has been a concerted effort to suppress the vote, making it harder to vote, making it harder to register, the need for a specialized set of identification cards in order to vote, okay? And this has been particularly true in some of the states. You can argue that Pennsylvania is one of those states where voter suppression was successful. Same thing in North Carolina, okay, was successful. You can't argue that in the state of Florida, which actually has a fairly open and efficient way of registering people to vote, okay? So there's something else going on here on whether it's easy or hard to vote. I think that if we wanted to open up the process, making registration easier is the way to go. The problem is Americans don't want the government to know who we are. The idea of moving into a town and registering when you move into a town, just to register in the town as a resident of the town, is something Americans would not put up with. Okay? Even Donald Trump's family, okay? His grandfather didn't leave Bavaria legally. He didn't get an approval from the Bavarian government to leave Bavaria, therefore he couldn't come back. That's the new story within the last 2 days, okay?
He was an illegal emigrant, yes. Not immigrant.
Yes. Now, we don't want to do that in the United States. We don't want to, you know, go to the city hall and register when we move in, okay? But we're very happy in the state, you know, Florida. I vote in the state of Florida now, okay? We're very happy that the state of Florida says when you go and get a driver's license in the state of Florida, they ask you, do you want to register to vote at the same time? Now, that's very easy. Okay? You have to affirmatively say, no, I don't want to register to vote. Okay? And so if we complain about bad participation, it's because people don't want to participate. Okay? That's fine.
I mean, you have certain states where you said, you point out in terms of North Carolina, once again, Wisconsin, its laws were challenged as well in terms of registration. So you definitely have that going on. But I think there's a deeper, more fundamental point in terms of participation. And we saw that with Brexit as well, where in Great Britain, it's very easy to be able to vote. And still you had dramatic declines in participation on this fundamental vote about the future of the country and its place in Europe. And again, among millennials. Mm-hmm. So you saw a clear drop in voter participation in Great Britain among millennials. And certainly in the case of the United States as well. So you can look at the institutions and correctly so. But if we look back, for example, at presidential elections in the 19th century, you had participation in the 75 percentiles. You had avid participation among those who could vote, of course, in the 19th century, right?
It's all because we let women vote now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, you know, there's a technical debate here, but there's also one really about how people perceive democratic politics and their position in it that doesn't really have to do so much with rules. And you can see that by putting the United States in a bit of a comparative framework. That's why I'll be interested to see, for example, next year, how young people vote in the German national elections or in the French national elections. Because the evidence from the last national elections was a clear decline, as people somehow don't feel engaged by the narratives being offered, the choices being offered. And there's interesting issues there about how we as voters in modern democracies think about sensible politics, pragmatic politics, centrist politics, grand coalition politics, and what that does to our notions of motivation and really going to vote, so to speak. So it's a wonderful question with which to end the evening in the sense of...
Let me put in one more point here before you end it. The size of the House of Representatives has been fixed in law at 435 members for a century now, okay? In that time, the population of the United States has tripled, okay? 110 million to 330 million. That means, okay, women now vote. We didn't let them in 1910. Okay. The number of voters involved in every House of Representative election has increased six times. Okay. Women voting and threefold increase in the overall population. Running for the House of Representatives is now a major political investment. And running for the Senate is a huge financial investment, okay? Fewer and fewer ordinary people are running for the House of Representatives because it's too expensive. Okay, I can get elected to the state legislature or a city council. That was a cheap campaign to finance. But I've got to have about $5 million to run a reasonable campaign for the House of Representatives, okay? Because I'm trying to appeal to 750,000 potential citizens in my congressional district, okay? You want to open up the process to more diverse views? Increase the size of the House of Representatives so there are more districts out there that people can run for and a smaller number of voters that you need to win in order to get a seat in the House of Representatives.
That's an absolutely fascinating argument. And the way you can see Germany has tried to do that with the size of the Bundestag, for example, you know, having a third more people in the lower house and a fourth of our population of the United States. I mean, you can look at different things. Of course, you could do financial reform for U.S. elections, right? You could have the same amount of seats and just say, look, there's only so much cash in the game. And then, but we know how difficult that is in terms of American politics as well.
Yeah. And there's still current arguments about how far campaign finance spending control has been successful in Germany in achieving its ends.
Yeah. So we could go on for, I know there was many other hands in the room. I apologize for not seeing them. We've been having an animated discussion for just under 2 hours. I thank you very much for coming tonight, for your questions. The conversation will continue. We'll have many more events as the Trump era unfolds and what it means for transatlantic relations and the international conversation. So thanks a lot. Have a lovely evening and see you soon. Thank you.